Hey everyone, hopefully you still remember this face. I know it's been a while, sorry about that, but I am back today with a new video. For those of you watching me for the first time, my name is Arjun and on this channel, I make videos about personal finance, investing, crypto, credit cards, and all of that fun stuff. In this video, I wanted to talk about the personal finance metrics that I keep track of every month. And I feel like they've played a massive role in helping me stay on top of my finances. I know that there are a whole bunch of numbers thrown around. So in today's video, I wanted to focus on my top five. Up first, we have net worth. You may have guessed that this one was coming, but I put this right at the top because it's probably the single most important indicator of your finances. It's essentially your assets minus your liabilities. In this case, assets would be things like investment accounts, the value of your home, and savings, whereas liabilities would be things like credit card debt, student loans, and a mortgage. So when you take what you own and subtract out what you owe, you're left with a gap, and this gap is what represents your net worth. Your goal should be to try and grow this gap as much as you can. Here's a chart of my net worth progress since I started tracking it in 2019. You can see that it's completely normal to have drops along the way, but as long as the general trend is up and towards the right, you're doing a good job. To track this easily, you can use apps like Mint or Personal Capital, where you link all of your accounts and it does the calculation for you. Or you can just stick to old-fashioned spreadsheets if you're concerned about data privacy. I made an entire video on net worth, including how to calculate it with examples, and I've linked to that up here in case you want to learn more. Next up, we have the FI ratio or the financial independence ratio. This is your net worth divided by your financial independence number. I know we've already spoken about the numerator, so for now let's focus on the denominator. You're considered to be financially independent when you have enough money saved and invested to cover your living expenses forever. The easiest and most common way to determine this is using what's called the 4% rule. At the highest level, the 4% rule basically states that you can withdraw 4% of your portfolio every year and never run out of money. This comes from a study conducted by finance professors at Trinity University, who suggested that people who save 25 times their annual expenses can safely withdraw 4% of their portfolio every year. The idea behind this is that you can live off your investments indefinitely, assuming that the returns from a well-diversified portfolio is in the 5 to 8% range. There are some nuances to it in terms of how much you allocate to stocks versus bonds and how long your quote-unquote retirement is, but we're not going to go into that for this video. So, for example, if you wanted $60,000 a year in retirement, then you would need 60 times 25, which is $1.5 million saved up. Once you reach this number, then congratulations, you're considered to be financially independent. Now coming back to the FI ratio. Let's say that your current net worth is around $100,000. Then that would mean that your FI ratio is 100K divided by that 1.5 million. Or 6.66% in this case. You can then track your FI ratio every month to see how much closer you're moving towards your goal. FIRE, which is financial independence retire early, is actually something that I want to talk about more on this channel. And as I say that, I'm realizing that I should probably make a couple of dedicated videos on this. It is a concept that is near and dear to my heart, so make sure you keep an eye out for that one soon. Third on the list, we have expenses. Now, I do agree that tracking expenses is probably not the most glamorous thing we have in personal finance, but hey, it is definitely up there with the most effective. It can be really useful because it tells you exactly where you want to focus your attention. Sure, you could cut out those occasional $5 coffees, but maybe what the data is actually telling you is that your efforts are much better spent avoiding those expensive Nordstrom trips, for example. One thing to note here is that budgeting and tracking expenses is not about depriving yourself of fun. It's about having fun responsibly. There can still be room for vacations, entertainment, toys, as long as those expenses are intentional. Interestingly, my view on this has changed quite a bit over the years. I used to think that a budget was a non-negotiable and everybody just had to have one. But over time, I realized that once you have the right habits, systems, and goals in place, it actually becomes pretty hard to overspend. Moreover, if you've watched my simple money management video, which again I've linked to up here, you probably already know that I've automated my savings and investments to a point where I'm okay spending the money that's left in my checking account. Budgets can be a great starting point, don't get me wrong. But once you get into the flow of things, it may not be a necessity. Nowadays, I have a general idea of where my money is going, but I don't track every dollar. At number 4, we have savings rate. This is one of my most favorite personal finance metrics because it is the focal point for financial independence. It tells you how well you're managing your cash flow. In its most simplified form, it is your net savings divided by your total income. I think it's easiest understood with an example. Let's hypothetically assume that in a given month, I save $800 in my 401k with my employer matching $200 and $500 in my Roth IRA. In addition to that, I also saved up $500 in a savings account and my after-tax take-home pay is $6,000. Step one is to calculate net savings, which includes both non-retirement savings and retirement savings with employer contributions. So in this case, it would be 800 plus 200 plus 500 plus 500, leaving us with $2,000 in net savings. Step two is to calculate total income, which includes your after-tax take-home pay and your pre-tax contributions. Here, that would be 6,000 plus 800 plus 200, leaving us with $7,000 in total income. Notice how I didn't add the Roth IRA and savings portion to this because that comes out of your take-home pay. Step three is the easy part. You just divide 1 by 2 to get your savings rate. Here, that comes out to be 2,000 divided by 7,000 or 28.6% savings rate. There are a couple different ways to calculate this, but I think the method that I just went through is probably the most common one. Obviously, every month there are going to be different expenses that come up, so this number will fluctuate, but it still does give you a general idea of how well you're doing over time. The minimum savings rate that you should be looking at is at least 10% of your income, but if you want to see your net worth really accelerate, then you should be aiming for savings rate above 40%. Last but not least, we have credit score. Which is a number ranging from 300 to 850, telling lenders how trustworthy you are as a borrower. It's made up of 5 different factors, namely your credit history, the new credit you have, your payment history, amount owed, and your credit mix. The easiest way to improve your credit score is actually quite simple. Get a credit card, put some expenses on there, make sure you pay off the balance in full every month and keep that card open for as long as possible. Generally, the higher the credit score, the better it is. But you tend to get the best loan rates even with credit scores of 750 and above. So you don't really need to stress about getting that perfect credit score. You'll have 3 separate credit scores from each of the credit bureaus, namely Equifax, TransUnion, and Experian, but all of these scores should be fairly similar. Just a quick tip on this, you can get a free credit report from each of these 3 bureaus Once a year from annualcreditreport.com, link to down in the description box below. This is the most accurate representation of your credit score. So definitely make use of this to check and ensure that there's nothing wrong hidden inside your report. Again, I have a video dedicated to just this. So if you want the whole scoop with a wafer and sprinkles on top, you know where to go. Tracking all of these metrics only takes me around 10 minutes or so every month, but I feel like the value of doing so is priceless. It tells me exactly where I stand on my journey, and I can then make changes as required to get me to the place that I want to be. Do you keep a tab on all of these metrics? Or I don't know, maybe you keep track of different ones? Let me know in the comment section down below. If you did enjoy this video, don't forget to leave a like on your way out and subscribe if you haven't done so already. Thank you so much for watching this video, and peace out until next time. Bye bye.